hardcore gynecologist from the city of Mumbai. I'm a professor and I was the ex-dean of KJ Sumaya Medical College. First of all, a very good morning to all of you. And I really thank the organizer of this wonderful international conference on sexology. And also to my friend Sudha, who was responsible for my coming over to this wonderful city of Chennai. Coming to the topic of physiological changes which occurs at menopause and perimenopause, you know, it is a very important stage in a woman's life. Now, my talk is not going to be only on sexology, though it is a very important component of this conference, but ultimately when we look at a woman's life, we have to have a holistic view of the everything which occurs during this critical time of her life, that is the perimenopause and the menopause. Now, let us understand a desire of every person. Every man desired to live long, but no man would be old. No one wants to grow old, but it is inevitable that aging is a natural process. Everyone comes with an expiry date. Now, the association of various clinical symptoms during the perimenopausal and the menopausal years have been rightly or wrongly attributed to the ovaries. This is from time immemorial. I came across a statement which was written in 1887. Even during those days, the clinical symptomatology which came along the perimenopausal age group were wrongly attributed to the ovaries. They said, the ovaries after long years of service have not the ability of retiring in a graceful old age but become irritated. They transmit their irritation to the abdominal ganglia, which in turn transmit the irritation to the brain producing disturbances in brain tissue. So everything which occurred in her life, from insomnia to irritability to a decreased sexual intensity, arousal problems, sleep disturbances, everything was attributed to that ovary which was failing. This didn't happen with the man, this happened only with the woman. Now, with the long studies, we have understood it is not just the ovaries which are responsible. There are many more issues which come during this age group. Now, is it due to the ovarian function failure? Is it due to the lifestyle changes which occur during this period of time? Or it is simply an aging process which leads to all this symptomatology? Unless we go into the details of this, we will never find a possible solution for this problem. Now, let us see. During my grandmother's time or my mother's time, this was not an issue because many of the women didn't live to see their menopause and the postmenopausal years, because many a times the death occurred during the childbirth, death occurred due to various infectious diseases. But now with the advances in technology, we are living much more than what my mother and my grandmother lived. Now, if you see the life expectancy and the age at menopause, today if you see, because the longevity has increased, the life expectancy of a woman also has come to 65 and 70. One-third of the women in of their lifetime, they are going to spend in postmenopausal years. And therefore, all the symptoms which come during these years are going to be detrimental to their life, and therefore we had to find a solution for it. Now, let us see what is happening to the society. Now, if you see, we are becoming what is called as a rectangular society. That means there is a steadiness in the life expectancy from up to about 70 to 80 years, and then, of course, all this age-old illness comes, and suddenly many people are going to die. So we are going to have a lot of population which is going to live in the perimenopausal, menopausal, and postmenopausal years. Now, there are a lot of terminology which comes into picture, like premenopause, climacteric, postmenopause, etc. Now, what are these definitions and how it is important to it? Perimenopausal and premenopausal is a transitional phase where at some point of time, at about 38 to 40 years of age, the ovarian function starts decreasing. Now, why the ovarian function starts decreasing? Because the ovary comes with a predetermined follicle. And over a period of time, many of these follicles get depleted. And therefore, though the pituitary is sending the stimulation to the ovary, because of the non-availability of the follicles, the ovarian follicles do not respond. And this results in gonadotropin pushing the ovaries to perform, but the ovaries fail to perform. As a consequence of this declining, what happens first to occur is a menstrual irregularity. And we see more of anovulative cycles happening after the age of 40, between 40 to 50. So the first thing the woman notices about her middle age is cycles are no longer regular. This can be a boon for her or a bane for her. She may think that she is now becoming old, and she may get depressed because she is growing old. She is maybe going to lose her looks also. But at the same time, in what way it can be a boon for her? She thinks now she is free from the fear of pregnancy. But let me remind you, even during this anovulative cycle, there is a possibility in 10 to 15% of the cases they can become pregnant. So this has to be taken into consideration in a woman who has finished a family and she has no need for any childbearing function. Then, as far as the climacteric is concerned, it is a layman's term. We don't usually use this term in a medical terminology. It is a transition from the premenopause. Also, it encompasses menopause and it goes into postmenopause. When do we say menopause has occurred? It is like delivery. When we say normal delivery took place and everything is fine, I cannot predict. It is a retrospective diagnosis. Same is true for menopause. When we say a woman has attained menopause, it means that she has had a cessation of menstrual period for at least one year, then we say she has become menopause. And all the events which take place after the menopause, we call it as a postmenopausal state. Now, this is what I was talking about, the length of the menstrual cycle, that from in the initial period after the menarche start, the cycles are anovulative, so her cycle is not going to be that typical 28-30 day cycle. It is going to be 30, 40, 50 or 60 day cycle. Then by the age 20-25, it regularizes, and again by the age 40, the cycles tend to become irregular. That is a heralding signal of a transition from a normal reproductive cycle into a premenopausal cycle. So average age of onset is around about 46 years. For 95% of the women, it is 39 to 51 years. Average duration before she becomes menopausal is 5 years. And duration for 95% of the women is around 2 to 8 years. Now, is it that age of menopause, is it a constant feature? Now, we have seen over the time of evolution and we becoming more and more civilized, our importance about our health improved, especially about the girl's health, education improved, nutritional status improved. Over the years, we saw that there was a decline in the age of the menarche. Age of the menarche, when 20 years back or 30 years back, we used to say it was 14 years. Today, it has come to 11 to 12 years. And sometimes, the girls even start menstruating at the age of 10 years. So there has been a decline in the age of the menarche. But as far as the menopause is concerned, nothing much has changed. It is around about 50 years. That is what we say. And age of menopause is not influenced by the age at menarche. It is not that if you start your periods early, you are going to have menopause also early. So what are the other influences which may affect the menopause? That could be smoking. The women who smoke tend to have early menopause. Use of oral contraceptive, it tends to increase the age of menopause, maybe because when the woman is on OC pills for a long time, many of the ovary, the eggs are still there in the ovary, because the main action of a OC pill is inhibition of a ovulation. Of course, the socioeconomic status, obesity, and to some extent genetic factor. If the mother had an early menopause, it is likely that the daughter will also have an early menopause. Now, what is important, and the next what I am going to talk about, the physiological changes, is mainly dependent upon the main hormonal changes which are occurring at the time of menopause. Now, if you see, as I told you, where is the primary problem? The primary problem is in the ovary, because the eggs or the follicles have got depleted. Now, there are very few follicles which need to be developed. And because of this, what is influencing the follicles to grow? It is the pituitary. And pituitary is governed by the hypothalamus. I always say the menstrual function, this is what I tell my student, it is like every organ by itself is an expert. But to make music, you know, it's like an orchestra. To make music, you need a coordination between various instruments. You may be an expert, but if you don't coordinate with your fellow tabla player or a keyboard player, your music is not going to be soothing to the ears. The same is true that when the ovary starts failing, what the next thing does is it sends a signal. And the most important, we always thought the estrogen was the most important signal, which sent a signal to the pituitary to increase its output of gonadotropin. But today we know that it is not much of estrogen, but there is a substance called as inhibin B, which is produced by the follicle cells of the ovary, which sends a signal to the pituitary. And pituitary, in response to this falling level of the inhibin, starts increasing its output of gonadotropin to stimulate that aging ovary. So over a period of time, what happens? The estrogen level starts coming down, and the follicular stimulating hormone starts going up. Still, the balance is maintained up to menopause to some extent. But if you see, immediately when the menopause sets in, the estradiol levels go down drastically and the FSH level goes very high. How it is becomes important to us clinically is that when I say, I estimate the woman has got, amenorrhea, she comes to you with a lot of problems, I really want to know whether it is menopausal or whether it is due to some other reason. What I do, a simple estimation I do of the follicular stimulating hormone, which we normally call as FSH, and if it is more than 40, I know for sure that she is in a menopausal state. So it becomes important for me for diagnosis. And especially in a woman who has premature ovarian failure. That means instead of having menopause at 50, she comes with menopause at the age of 30, when I want to be sure that what is the cause for her going into menopause so early, and I do an estimation of FSH. I know it is more than 40. I know her ovaries have failed completely. I can still postpone her menopause, but she will need a supplementation of the hormones to maintain her physical and sexual health. So these are the principal hormone changes. This is more descriptive. Now what I want you to concentrate on, there is a fall in the hormone of every kind. You have fall in estradiol, you have fall in estrogen, estrone. These are the two principal hormones which are circulating in the body. Before menopause, estradiol is more predominant, but if you see with menopause, that falls down drastically. So comparatively, estrone becomes a more dominant hormone. I talked about FSH. Luteinizing hormone also is a hormone produced by the pituitary, which increases, but not to the same extent as FSH. What is most important for us is if you see the testosterone. See, the woman and man both have both the hormones. It is what is predominant, what makes a man and a woman. Now, if you see the testosterone level in this woman, there is a fall because the testosterone and androstenedione also to some extent come from the ovaries. There is a fall, but their fall is not so evident as the fall of a estrogen. So what happens in a postmenopausal woman is that there is a slight preponderance of a testosterone compared to the estrogen. Now, how it becomes evident, it is, the people who are menopausal know about
it. I request Dr. Sudhar Tandonji, come on the dice.
So,
to interpret, madam.
So what happens, how clinically it becomes evident is that because there is a slight elevation, it is not high elevation, but compared to the estrogen is, during the ages by 50, when she becomes menopausal, they start sprouting moustache. It is a very common problem the women have. They start developing moustache and beard, which they never had. and this is because of this physiological change which occurs. This is in turn about the blood production rate of steroids, which is in terms of calculation of in nanograms, which I have talked about, which is the same thing which I told you, there is a fall in all hormones, estrogen as well as the testosterone. We are not talking about the progesterone because by now she has become an anability cycle, there is no production of progesterone. Now, what are the kinds of menopause we can have? We can have a natural menopause and we can have a surgical menopause. For some reason, if a oophorectomy has been done at a younger age, and the day she has her oophorectomy has been done, she goes into a phase of menopause. How it becomes different from a natural menopause? In a natural menopause, the transition is very smooth. Whereas in a surgical menopause, the transition is very abrupt. And therefore, some of the symptoms associated with menopause is going to be more exaggerated in a patient who has got a surgical menopause compared to a natural menopause. Which we already talked about, the main culprit in a menopause is the ovaries. That they shrink, the follicles degenerate, this results in fluctuating hormones to attempt to maintain the status, and later on there is a sharp drop in estrogen. Now, lot of things have been attributed to the menopause, and in this the main points are the effect the menopause has on neuroendocrinal organs, the effect it has on urogenital organs, and effect it has on the systemic organs. Now you can see all things have been attributed to menopause. She has hot flushes and hot flashes. We are not going to deny that it does have a background of a estrogen loss, night sweats. Again, it is a very irritating symptom for the woman. Now, as far as depression, irritability, mood swings, sleep disturbances, insomnia, is it actually because of the estrogen loss? Or is it because of the lifestyle changes which are going to occur in the middle age? Let us see a woman of 40, 45, 50. Is she going to be the same as she was 30? Apart, I'm not talking about her physical or physiological thing. What is happening to her day-to-day life? What is happening to her relationship with her family? At this point of time, there is a possibility she herself is suffering from physical disease. Her spouse may be absent, or he may be suffering from physical disease or a disability. What has happened to the children? Children, so far her life center was around the children. Children have got educated, they got married, or they got a job, and they are leading a life to themselves. And this leads to what is called as an empty nest syndrome. At some point, her looks are waning, she is having her own problems, and then on the top of it, that she feels unwanted. She feels at this, till now, I was the center point of my family and I am no longer needed. If she is a working woman, things do change. There is a retirement coming which comes with the financial insecurity. So many a times, all these factors also compound to her problems. So it is very wrongly, it is wrong for us to say that everything is because of the loss of ovarian function. So these are some of the things which can come with the urogenital, that is the vaginal atrophy, dryness, increase in the frequency of urinary tract infection, loss of libido, etc. What happens to the systemic? There is a weight gain. Again, we do not know it is because of the estrogen loss or it is because of the lifestyle change which occurs. More body fat, muscle pain, stiffness, thickening around the waist and loss of muscle mass because the lack of estrogen also has its effect on the connective tissue. And the last but not the least are the two important events which occurs due to the lack of estrogen, which can make her, it may kill her or it can make her life bedridden. That is the osteoporosis and the fractures associated with the osteoporosis. The other thing is, which can happen is dementia, stroke, Alzheimer's disease, which are attributed to the loss of estrogen with the menopause. Now, if you see the duration, it does not that all the symptoms start with the menopause. There are few symptoms which start before the menopause starts, and one of the few symptoms which starts before the menopause sets in is the vasomotor symptom, that is the very typical and very irritating and very debilitating problem, which is not, does not kill the patient, but it changes the quality of the life the patient is going to have, that is the hot flushes, night sweats, and because of that, what happens is her sleep gets disturbed. So it changes her entire lifestyle. And then over a period of time, the other thing sets in, and then of time comes when the menstruation ceases. And if you see the chronic events, what will happen is there is a loss of skin connective tissue, the pelvic floor, which results in all the urogenital symptoms. And last, and which comes many years after that, is the cerebrovascular accidents, coronary heart diseases, and osteoporosis. These are the changes which locally occur because of the estrogen deficiency, that there is atrophic changes in the vagina, vulva, reduction in the uterine size, and the ovary becomes sclerotic. This is what I talked about, the vasometer changes. Now we are going to go into the system one by one, and let us come to the conclusion. Is it the estrogen deficiency which is leading to it? And if it is, does she require a treatment with the estrogen? Vasometer changes, as I told you, it may not kill her, but it makes her life miserable, because what we mean by the vasometer symptoms and hot flushes is suddenly she gets a burning sensation in or heat sensation in her body. There is a reddening of her upper part of the body, that is the face, the head, the neck and the chest. And she feels such an intense heat that there are women who come and tell that we just go under the shower and we cool ourselves. With the cooling of the body temperature, these symptoms settle down. This can happen every day. It can happen more than once a day. And this goes on for months, years. And a period comes after 4 to 5 years of the menopause. By now, the body has got used to the lack of estrogen and these symptoms disappear. And this needs to be treated. And one of the best way to treat this is by giving estrogen supplementation. Then the second, I talked about physiological, about the irritability, the mood changes, etc. Now, we really do not know whether it is because of the estrogen loss or it is because of the circumstances around her which is creating this problem. So, to say that a negative view of the mental health at the time of menopause is not justified, because many of the problems reported at menopause are due to the life events. So, in summary, the studies have shown that 85% of experience the perimenopausal transition without mood difficulties. Some women are at a greater risk for the new set of depressive symptoms, and this is probably enhanced by the hormonal variation and the vasomotor symptom. These vulnerable women are likely derived from a group of premenopausal women with underlying psychological problems. This is very important before we start with the remedial measure. It is also possible that the perimenopausal hormone changes create a state that makes an individual less able to deal with these adverse events of life. Now, we know a lot about dementia and Alzheimer's disease. This is something I think every family, including the patient himself, dread, that you don't know who you are. You lose your identity. Now, to some extent, it has been proved beyond doubt that the estrogen protects the CNS function because it protects against the cytotoxicity. It increases the synapses and the neuronal growth. But what is important is that if you want to have an effect of estrogen on maintaining this health, it should be a primary prevention. It should not be a secondary. That means if a neuronal damage has already taken place and now the patient is going to develop symptoms and signs of Alzheimer's, at this point of time, if you start with hormone replacement therapy, it's not going to work. It will work only when the brain cells are still normal and you use it as a preventive this. Sleep disturbances, it is very common at this age. There is a latency of sleep, that means you have problem in falling to sleep, could be because of the anxiety disorder, fragmented sleep, maybe because your sleep gets disturbed due to night sweats and the urinary dysfunction which comes, so they need to go to the toilet very often, and early awakening may be due to depression. So estrogen has not been proved to be the major cause for a sleep disturbance. Then you have urogenital problems, that is incontinence. When we say incontinence, it means the involuntary passage of the urine, that she has a bout of cough and she passes urine, she cannot hold on. What happens because of that? This urge incontinence, when she needs to go to the toilet, if there is no toilet, she will have incontinence. So psychologically what it does to the patient is it makes her a social recluse. She fears going outside because she thinks that if there is no toilet available, what will happen to me? And to a large extent, this is because of the estrogen, protective action of the estrogen on the connective tissue of the pelvic floor. So decreased estrogen initiates the thinning and weakening of the pelvic muscles and the connective tissue, leading to decreased tone elasticity and the supplements of the pelvic floor. And in some women, the pelvic floor exercise may help. Some women may need a hormone replacement therapy. Now, these are the various causes other than menopause which can lead to a pelvic floor damage. And many a times, all these are associated also in these older women because they've had children, they might have had a hysterectomy for some reason, they are retired and sitting at home, so they have a sedentary lifestyle. What are the features of a weak pelvic floor? They have this incontinence, they have incomplete bowel and bladder emptying, they have diminished sexual satisfaction, they may have prolapse, and because of the prolapse, they may have a back pain. Now we come to the theme of this conference, the menopause and sexuality. I'm not going to go into the detail because there are eminent speakers after me who will be tackling this issue. There is a problem at menopause, head and bottom are not connected. My head really wants to have sex, but my vaginal area is dead, it seems. Or it is painful and therefore I don't want to have it. This is basically associated with the lack of estrogen on the vagina, which leads to the vaginal dryness. Or how do I get that feeling in my head to match the feeling below? So I want to have, but there is something which is in the brain which stops me from having. Whether it's an arousal problem, whether it is a libido, lack of libido, we do not know. We need to explore this. So, other than this, is there anything which relates to sexual function? Decline in the physical health. This leads to decline in the sexual activity, decline in the androgen levels, which leads to decline in desire, and therefore many a times testosterone is advocated for these women. Decline in the estrogen levels leads to decline in orgasm, and it can lead to a painful coitus because of the vaginal thinning. These are the sexual responses. I think we can skip this. The two other important events which occur in menopause, which can affect our physical, mental, and sexual health, is a risk of cardiovascular risk. It is shown that in a woman who is premenopausal, her risk of dying from a coronary artery disease is 20 times less than a man dying of a coronary artery disease at the same age. So what is this which prevents the woman from dying of a heart attack before menopause is, one is the presence of estrogen. So estrogen has a cardioprotective effect on the heart. Now, we may say lifestyle also, maybe men work harder, they take more stress, women don't have any stress, and therefore they don't die of heart attack. It is wrong. But because in today's world, I think women take equally the same risk like men, or maybe more than men, because they have to take care of house and work. And if I go to work, no one is going to give me any excuse just because I am a woman. They say, you have taken this job, you better do this job. It doesn't matter whether you are a man or a woman. Even in these circumstances, their risk of dying from a coronary artery disease and a myocardial infarction is much less than men. So that means what is there in her which protects her, and the bottom line is estrogen. And how does this estrogen is going to help? It is basically, it has its protective action on the endothelial function, but more important than that is it has it is not the more estrogen but lack of androgens compared to that estrogen which protects the heart by its main action on the coronary atherosclerosis. And why does the atherosclerosis occur? It occurs because of a imbalance of her lipid profile. So these are the optimum lipid profile a woman should have, that when she goes for these checkups, that her total cholesterol should be less than 200, HDL should be more than 50, LDL should be less than 100, and triglyceride should be less than 150. So in this case, even if she becomes menopausal, she is protected. Now there is a term called metabolic syndrome, which designates which woman is at a higher risk of developing a coronary artery disease. Any hypertensive woman, a woman with high triglyceride, cholesterol, an abdominal circumference more than 35 inches, which is again indicator of a metabolic syndrome, because in these women, they have a little relatively androgen excess compared to the estrogen and who is a diabetic. So these are the protective action of the estrogen, that they have more nitric oxide and prostacyclin production, which is a vasodilator and antithrombotic effect, and they inhibit the oxidative action of the LDL. The other important thing is effect of the menopause on the bones. Now we know that the bone is a very active organ. Constantly there is a remodeling which is going on, which is characterized by osteoclastic activity and osteoblastic activity. So these are the various process which goes: activation, resorption, reversal, formation and mineralization. And the whole thing takes about 6 to 8 months to occur. And this is constantly going on in everyone. But what happens with menopause is the osteoclastic activity, that means resorption of the bone, becomes more predominant than the bone formation. This results in the thinning of the bone, what we call as osteopenia, leading to osteoporosis. And this woman, because of the various reason, falls down, she tends to have a fracture, which can be debilitating for her. And which are the bones which are involved? They are basically trabecular bones. When we say it is the wrist, the spine and the femur neck, classically you can see there is a compression fracture, osteoporotic changes in the spine. As a result, you see the women become shorter as the age advances and they develop what is called as a Dowager's hump, which is very common and which happens. You cannot do anything about it. Can we do anything about it? Yes, we can prevent these risk factors apart from menopause, which we cannot avoid. It is more common in certain races, family history, addiction. That you can have control over. Smoking is considered to be a risk factor for development of osteoporosis. Be active. And if you are on medication like steroids, you have to be careful. If you have hyperthyroidism, you have to be careful. So to some extent, we can say that non-modifiable factors and potentially modifiable factors we can have to prevent the development of the osteoporosis. What else we need to do to prevent this problem of osteoporosis? It doesn't start with menopause, because your calcium deposition and your bone mineral density, what I am talking about, starts at the early age of 20s and 30s. So if you have a good bone density at that point, the rate of bone loss after menopause is also going to be less. Whereas if you start only with this negative problem, then the problem gets confounded with the menopause. So eat well, have a healthy adolescence and the growing up years, have a good mineral bone density, and then your chances of having osteoporosis after menopause is going to be reduced. Is it possible for me to test this bone mineral density? There are various tests which are available. From there, you can come to know how good you are as far as your bones are concerned. Do you need to take care, or can you be happy about it and you can forget it? So what can happen is that if already your bone mineral density is low, maybe that is a place you may have to start with hormone replacement therapy. And the earlier you start, it is better, because once the changes have occurred in the bone, they are not going to come back. This is a true fact about hormone replacement therapy, that whatever you need to start when the primary organ is still well. Once it gets disease, you cannot revert it back. Now these are all the, now why I have shown these references is because when this topic came, I said, let me go through the literature. If you see, there is so much of confounding and contradictory studies which have come all over the world. There is not much as far as the Indian literature is concerned, but a lot of work has been done in the Western literature. There is such conflict. One says estrogen is useful, somebody says it's not useful, because estrogen cannot be given like a multivitamin tablet. It has got its side effects, it has an adverse effect on the, if it may have protective effect on the bone and the heart, it has an adverse effect on the breast and the endometrium. So we don't want that one thing we help and the other thing she develops a cancer of the endometrium or the cancer of the breast. So we need to take a balance in whom we should give, in whom we can change the lifestyles and things will be important, and in whom definitely we should not give. So for this, I went through it. and there is conflicting reports. These are the very major studies which are done in the world, like Swan study, HERS, etc. So you can go through the details if you want to know this. Last but not the least, as I told you, aging is inevitable. We all come with the expiry date, and how we make best use of the age we are in matters. So a positive mind gives rise to a positive body. So if wrinkles must be written upon your brows, let them not be written upon the heart. The soul should not grow old. I think with this, I thank you all for a patient listening.